Good evening. Thanks for your patience. So welcome to tonight's keynote lecture featuring Dr. Bryan Hotchkins' talk entitled Reframing Student Success Holistically as an Institutional Outcome. We're excited to have everybody here. I'm Gary Marcorp, and I'm Associate Professor of History and Co-Faculty Fellow for the Diversity and Inclusion at the College. Before we get to tonight's introduction of Dr. Hotchkins, I'd like to speak for a moment about the B.W. Bastian Foundation that generously and graciously sponsors the Bastian Foundation Diversity Lecture Series at Westminster College. The foundation, which was established in 1996 by Bruce W. Bastian, strives to build community and understanding by supporting local and national institutions. Financial support is directed to educational outreach and cultural and HIV/AIDS programs. A strong commitment is placed on programs and organizations that benefit, encourage, and preserve the rights of individuals and promote equality for the gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender communities. The theme for this year's Bastian Foundation Lecture Series is Diversity in the Future of Higher Education. This theme acknowledges the often challenged yet persistent expansion of ideas, identities, and voices in today's colleges and universities. It calls for a critical inquiry into the role diversity plays in the development and implementation of current and future policies and practices in higher education. It also facilitates multiple opportunities to explore this ambitious and provocative subject matter. Along with the series' signature lectures, the leaders invited to contribute to this inquiry include scholars, practitioners, and activists engaging with Westminster's students, staff, faculty, and community members in classroom activities, group conversations, panel discussions, and other formats to closely engage with this theme in creative and innovative ways. Future diversity lecture series will be announced at the end of today's program. Right now, I hand it over to Westminster student, to Shell Wright, who will introduce tonight's speaker. Thank you.
Hi, so my name is Tichelle Wright, and I am a McNair Scholar and the current Black Student Union President here at Westminster College, and I have the honor of introducing our speaker, Dr. Bryan K. Hotchkins. So he is a critical race organizational leadership scholar who earned a Ph.D. from the University of Utah in educational leadership and policy with a focus in higher education. Dr. Hotchkins currently operates a cultural leadership bridge program called The Village in Utah, which serves 10 schools throughout the state. The Village focuses on leadership, development, cultural validation, positive academic outcomes, and community engagement of students who self-identify as Black. Dr. Hotchkins' research focuses on how institutions of higher education engineer the creation of an equitable public life for holistically disenfranchised people. Specifically, in what ways do institutional climates impede or positively influence the access, retention, and completion of underrepresented students, ultimately student success. So I would like you guys to join me in welcoming Dr. Hotchkins.
Thank you for the introduction. Thank you everyone for coming tonight. Close your eyes and come with me on a journey. There's a bus stop in a city somewhere in America. There are students waiting to be picked up and taken to school. The bus is typically 25 minutes late. When the bus arrives, students file onto the bus slowly. Some students don't have backpacks, so they carry their books in their hands. The students who are sitting on the bus are fidgeting, they're loud, some of them are cursing. The bus drives through the neighborhood, which is clearly impoverished. There are abandoned buildings with broken windows. As the bus drives over the railroad tracks and across the bridge, the bus arrives at the school. The students file off the bus. The bus driver comments as students leave the bus, "I hate having to bring you here each morning." The students single file through a metal detector. They place their book bags on the table to be checked. Some students go straight to class late, so they are marked tardy upon their arrival. A couple of students gather together and go out of the back door of the school to ditch school for the day. Another group of students meets in the boys' restroom to discuss jumping someone that they know in their neighborhood into their gang set. The students who are in the classroom are restless, they're loud. The teacher is sitting with her head on the desk, feeling defeated because this is an everyday ritual. As you see this picture in your mind, what are the races of the students in the narrative? You can open your eyes. That story is where some of your students of color who come to your institution have been placed by you before they even arrive. I won't ask what race you saw of students, but if you're honest with yourself, you may not have saw yourself in that narrative. When students come to campus, they have valuable narratives and experiences that they bring. Those narratives and experiences often exceed our low expectations of them as administrators, staff, faculty at institutions of higher ed. This presentation is about how we begin to reframe and see what is valuable that students bring to our campuses and how we use those to enhance our institutional outcomes. So there are three topics, questions really, that I'll focus on. The first one is, how do colleges and universities conceive excellence and or success in relation to critical thinking, social responsibility, and self-actualization? How do their experiences of marginalized college student groups, particularly black men, challenge and inform institutional definitions of excellence? What is the relationship between institutional conception of excellence and supports for underrepresented students? Thank you for that introduction. Often, scholarly introductions talk about what we do on campuses, but they really talk about who we are. And so even though I have a PhD, it allows me to profess. But it is not essential to my being, right? And so these persons who are pictured are part of who I am and why I do what I do. And so at the top, your left, that's my peoples. It's only four Hotchkins that live in Utah, and they all live in my house. So if you ever need to find them, that's where they are, right? At the top left, that is our graduation day. I completed my PhD, Ed Leadership and Policy. Nedra completed her master's, Ed Leadership and Policy. I wouldn't recommend being married and both persons going to graduate school at the same time. The good thing about it is everyone does homework, everyone's at the library. So pick up kids, got homework, kids are falling asleep in the library because we're there to 10 midnight some nights, right? So we learn as a family. The village. You've heard a little bit about it, and I'll elaborate about it more. For me, having a village experience is cathartic. I often joke, if you have siblings you are familiar with this game called Where's Waldo? And so I play Where's Waldo, black version, at the U almost every day I'm there, right? And so the village is an extension of family for me. The middle picture is me having fun. There is a program called Expect the Great. And so Expect the Great happens annually. It is for Black student leaders, roughly 10 colleges and universities in the state. And they meet over 2 days, well, a night, half a day and a night and a day, to discuss best practices for surviving, moving into thriving on predominantly white institutional campuses, how they can become better leaders, how they can engage, how can they identify resources and utilize those for the collective benefit of Black students on their campuses. Last picture, this person who's in the pictures here today. The community village is for white parents who have Black children. And so it is an exercise in learning and sharing ideas and exchanging thoughts about how we can protect our Black children in spaces not limited to Utah, but empower them to navigate through this world that is predominantly white. And so, what do I do specifically? 2010, Latson Billings comes to the University of Utah. She is what I affectionately call the mother of critical race theory. She gives a great talk. After that talk, I knew I wanted to be a critical race scholar. And I say to her, my wife hasn't heard the story. So I say to her, if I was 30 years older, I would be your husband. I never heard anybody talk like that before. And she said to me, baby, my son's older than you. But thank you. And we begin to have a discussion in which she says to me, you are in the academy, but you are not of the academy. And it just confirmed this notion that I have to journey into the academy to create spaces for the people that will come after me, right? And so as a scholar, this is my research paragraph talk, right? So my research agenda, for the next 30 years, I will be asking this question. In what ways does higher education engineer an equitable public life for underrepresented populations? Broadly, I focus on post-secondary access, retention, completion, and equity issues. Narrowly, I focus on higher ed as a generator of equity, contextual context for student success, cultural incongruence of identities, organizations, and college pathways for marginalized student entrants. And so my grandmother told me, when I tell stories, start from where you are to journey backwards, right? And so this is Google Maps. I love Google Maps. I have an iPhone, and so I use Google Maps instead of the Maps app that comes with the iPhone that always takes you to the wrong place, right? One thing Google Maps can never tell me how to do is how to navigate predominantly white institutions, right? The drive from University of Oklahoma to here is about 18 hours. It is a long drive. I'm from Oklahoma. That's where I was born and raised. Coming to the University of Utah changed the trajectory of my family tree. I used to tell people in my first year as a doc student, I'm only leaving Utah one or two ways, in a casket or as Dr. Hotchkins. And people would laugh, right? They're like, it ain't that serious. But it was that serious to me. It was moving my family towards the next phase of life, right? And so being at the University of Utah was challenging. I have forgotten how to be a student. I have forgotten how to read 200 pages of readings a week, to deconstruct those readings and represent those readings in ways that were meaningful to me. I have never shared this in a public setting in a speaker capacity, but I will now. 2009, I'm in class. Everyone's going around unpacking ourselves in an exercise. I'm typing, surfing, like I don't like my students to do. My students are all here on the front row, by the way. I'll let them introduce themselves at the conclusion. And so I'm typing, and people go around. There's a white female in the class who I was told was an ally, says, one of the hardest things that I'll have to deal with is the fact that my parents are racist, and they raised me in a racist house. I'm surfing. And she says, yeah, I remember when I was younger, we wanted to go swimming. And my daddy said, we can't go because the park is closed because of that expletive N-word holiday for Martin Luther King Jr. So I look up and I look at her, and the next person starts talking. And then the next person starts talking, and the person after that. And I say, wait, I know y'all see me sitting here, right? And even though I'm not that N-word, I'm offended. Cultural violence has occurred every time I hear it said, right? And the silence in the room tells me that you're either cool with it or you're in collusion. And these were the people that I was introduced to as allies who got it, right? That was the last day that I combed my hair. Each time I tell the story, I'm mindful that I am traumatized in repeating it, but it is helpful for some to hear it. My hair is a representation of my resistance of whiteness at that university, even though I'm employed there and I try my best to educate students in that space. I'm mindful that it doesn't happen in a vacuum, right? Needless to say, we overcame, I graduated. University of Oklahoma, another epiphany moment. I'm first generation college going, and so I didn't have guidance. My parents dropped me off at my undergraduate institution and said, good luck, we'll see you in May. That's my pops. My pops gives me the rites of passage talk. Son, it's almost time for you to graduate. I don't know if you're going to get a job, if you're going to the military or college, but you got to get up out of here the day after you graduate. And I was like, I'm going to college, right? And so I go to the University of Oklahoma, and I say, I want to get a master's in human relations. And they say, let me see your transcript. I said, okay, here it is. And they say, you have a 2.9 cumulative GPA. We're going to admit you on academic probation. And you have to get 5 A's in the first 5 classes in order for you to matriculate on in the program. I never asked to see the policy. If that even was a policy, needless to say, I graduated. But that was one of those moments when I said, I have to be committed to this process, right? Go back even further. This picture right here is really old, right? These are my boys from back in the day. All of us, first generation, college going, right? And so I remember one time, so because we're nerds, we had friends that they had these signing days, right? And we would mock them. Like, they're like, I'm going to the University of Colorado. And we'd be like, so we had our pretend nerd signing day, right? And I was like, I'm going to SMU. And my other friends were like, I'm going here. The person in the white shirt is Dr. Andre Washington. He's a professor at Langston University, a historically black college and university, the one that is farthest west in Oklahoma. He completed his PhD before me. Before I was ready to defend, he said, I sent something to the mail, go check. I went to the mail, it was a shirt, white shirt that said PhD on it. But it was on the inside. And I said, something's wrong with the shirt. And he said, no, it's not. It is your future. When you put it on, you'll be able to feel the letters on your chest to remind you that when you defend your dissertation, you're the most knowledgeable person in that room. Needless to say, I defended my dissertation successfully. I am still in touch with each one of them. Making the journey to my undergraduate school, Southern Methodist University, again was different and challenging. I hadn't realized that I had a low cultural self-esteem and that my high school, my K-12 knowledge and understanding of being black, there was a disservice that occurred, right? And so I journeyed to SMU where I met a lot of people that I would say were Carlton on the Fresh Prince, right? And they would say I was hood. And so there was a lot of jousting, playing the dozens. Some of y'all know what playing the dozens is. Occurring amongst black communities on a socioeconomic status, which I was unfamiliar with. I didn't know what a passport was until I saw someone black with one. I had never even envisioned leaving the country, let alone leaving Oklahoma, right? And so, fraternity life. My freshman year, second semester, I joined Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated, the first of all black Greeks. My GPA, first semester was a 2.8. Second semester when I pledged, it was a 2.6. Third semester, it was a 2.4. Fourth semester, it was a 2.4. Fifth semester, it was a 3.5. It took me 2 years to begin to learn what being in college is about. That time was comprised of me joining my fraternity to seek a brotherhood, because no one is telling you as a freshman about the value of brotherhood, about what Yancey talks about as the strength of an ethnic enclave, of being in a space where my blackness is not critiqued, is not judged. I was called country a lot. Hey, I get it. I'm country, not Southern. There's a distinct difference. By black persons who were third generation college going. And so they had been prepared with the navigational hidden rules of how to occupy, demand, be entitled in that space, right? Extracurricular activities. And so I am melanin enriched. So that's me in the orange hat. So it just looked like the hat is floating. That's me right there. Orange hat at the football game. So we went to every SMU football game, every SMU basketball game, every SMU extracurricular activity that we could go to find a sense of belonging, right? I was active in organizations. So I was president of the Black Student Union because I needed cultural grounding, right? And I was president of the Public Relations Student Society of America because I needed professional grounding. My degree, undergraduate, is in communications with emphasis in public relations. At the time, most of this research that has transpired since then was not in existence when I was attending SMU. In hindsight, each and every one of these is something that I enacted without guidance. And so Tierney talks about committing cultural suicide within the context of indigenous students, about when you come to campus, realize that you can never be assimilated in whiteness. You can be acculturated. So spending energy trying to fit in, trying to dress like, talk like, walk like, act like, is a waste of your time. Embrace your cultural norms, even if they are seen as abnormal in a predominantly white institutional space. Fictive kin. Herndon and Hurt talk about finding persons on campus who are similar to you culturally to serve as kin. So I had relationships. I knew who the janitor was. I knew who the ladies were in the cafeteria. I knew who the three black professors were at my school. I knew the pastor. I knew persons. I had to create a second family that was fictive, that helped me, that guided me, that supported me in the process. Academic engagement. I didn't know anything about study groups, how long to study, when is studying too long, too much. And so I had to engage academically in the space and had to be taught how to study. I had to be taught how to write. I really had to be taught how to read for comprehension and context. My high school didn't. Nothing that I learned in K-12 taught me that. Leadership involvement, as I mentioned, it was crucial for me to be involved in organizations and not just sit in what we called at the time my dorm room and not be engaged on campus. Campus racial climate. Hurtado's canon piece doesn't come out until 92, and it is about Latino students. What we were experiencing at SMU was a hostile campus racial climate in hindsight. There were 15 black males that were freshmen when I entered. We all stayed in the same quad. When we returned on our sophomore year, there were only 6 of us left, and 4 of us graduated, of the ones that I knew in my cohort. To be at SMU in the 90s meant that you were intelligent. I was a nerd, graduated 3.8, 18th in my class. Right? So I was Steve Urkel, but just in college, right? But repeatedly, there were black students that didn't come back, that transferred out, and because they don't have exit interviews, we just knew they didn't come back, and we didn't know why. Spiritual engagement. Robert Palmore was a doctoral student in seminary at the time I went to SMU. And we went to him and said, we need some Jesus. Help us. He negotiated with the seminary school to have us use. So there was a place where the Methodist persons met on campus. And after that, we were allowed to use it for Baptist praising of Jesus. And it was foundational to our sanity. It was a space where we could unpack, where we could vent, where we could pray, where we could come and fall apart and leave rebuilt, right? Faculty relationships. I'm a talker, as you can tell. And so I would stop and talk and check in on my faculty members around that junior year. In casual ways, not during office hours, I would just step in. Me having direct access and interactions with faculty members, I believe, was part of the reason why my GPA soared. I don't know if they had deficit perceptions of me as a black male on the campus, but I do know that in purposefully engaging in with them, I was exposed to study groups. I was exposed to National Merit Scholars who I could study with, who I would have never even known that. I didn't even know what a National Merit Scholar was. And the last one is responsive interest preservation. Derek Bell talks about interest convergence in 1979 as whiteness will never do anything to help black people better themselves in America unless they benefit from it. What the students in this study that I'm going to talk about tonight were exhibiting is responsive interest preservation. They are vetting whiteness to see who is dangerous, who is supportive, and aligning themselves purposefully with those white students, faculty, and staff who are supportive to utilize their resources for the betterment of the black students on campus. Terayoso frames this notion of community cultural wealth, which is what I was experiencing at SMU prior to it being published. In the center, community culture wealth, surrounding it, different types of capital that students of color bring to your campus that we don't measure as scholars and administrators yet, right? And so they have aspirational capital. I said, I want to go to college. I don't know how I was going to do it. I just aspired to do it. Nobody in my family had ever done it. The fact that I believed that I could, there was capital in that. I was unwavering. I knew that I would, again, graduate, pine box, finish, right? Familiar capital, my parents. There were times when I would call home as a freshman. So imagine this, students. In my dorm, there's one phone at the end of the hall that's brown, and you have to pick it up. And when you hear the tone, dial the number, right? And then someone will call you back. Nope, no. AOL yet. Yikes, I'm dating myself. But I would call home, and my mom or my grandma would say, what's your problem? I don't think I can do it. Bow your head. Lord, please watch over him. And I would have rebirth and confidence, right? So no one in my family, I would come home, Christmas break, we'd have these prayer circles. We have a ritual of my mom cooking for people to come to the home. And I would just be in the prayer circle in the center, all the women in my family praying for me to do well. They couldn't tell me how to study. They couldn't tell me how to navigate whiteness. They couldn't tell me a variety of things, but what they could do is undergird me with religion, right? Social capital. Social capital varies. It depends on the person. And it is contingent upon navigational capital, right? And so I was the president of the Black Student Association. And then when I declared my major my junior year, I joined PRSSA and became president, and it shifted my navigational capital. So now people were asking me to come to things as president that normally I would never gotten an invite to, or nor did I know even existed, right? So I learned to, through my organizational ties, navigate spaces. Resisting capital, I alluded to it earlier about my hair. I have some pictures that I tried to find. And so there's one picture in particular, I had my nose pierced, had my African cane, and so I was wearing a dashiki. I didn't realize, I wasn't taught about the legacy of African greatness until I went to SMU, ironically. And I went from myself to super black, right? So whatever Malcolm was, I was like, way up here, right? Because I never experienced cultural pride in ways that mattered. I was taught in my high school, black people began in the hull of a slave ship. That was my departure point for narrative. So I didn't have anything to be proud of, right? But again, SMU shaped me. Linguistic capital. Even though I am not bilingual, I can make the argument that I can speak to black people, and some of you know not what I'm saying, right? And there's capital in an expression that is exclusive to and within a specific culture. So before I put this talk together, I wanted to think about what are the typical institutional metrics, right? And so I went to Westminster's website. And so I surfed for a little bit. These are quantitative ways of saying these are the points that institutions value, right? And so if you look on the website, we have 3,300 applicants last year, 1,800 were accepted, 471 came, 25% yield. You have more females than males. You have 6 black students in the freshman class. In learning and having a lunch yesterday, there are only 68 black students attending Westminster. What is funny is that every time I said that to someone, the few persons who work here or other students, they said, "Where they at? Where they at?" Because they playing Waldo, black version 2, right? Here at Westminster. Where they at? I don't see them. Can't be 68. Can't be. Right? And so then we go across to tuition and fees for you Westminster students, $31,000, $39,000. The average financial aid given is $26,000. There is a gap there of $12,000. Unless you have the financial resources, even if you take out loans, most loans for undergraduates are $4,500, there's still gonna be a gap, right? Then I go to class represented by 33 states. What is intriguing to me is the states that are missing: Alabama, Kentucky, Louisiana, Mississippi, my state, Oklahoma, South Carolina, Virginia. Most of those states seceded from the Union. They are populated by black people, right? So there's someone who is here that is over enrollment and recruitment. We could talk afterwards. I have some ideas about increasing the black student population here at Westminster. They are proud of 9 countries being represented, right? They have 10 valedictorians. Average GPA, 3.5. Average ACT, 24.7. Average SAT, 1,100, basically. I could have gotten into Westminster. Right? Class by top rank, top 10%, 22%, top 25%, 53%, top 50%, 84%. And even in the 50th percentile in the middle, 22 and 24, were the ACT scores. My question is, how do we reframe and define student success within the intersection of culture, academics, and communal engagement? My initial response is that we start measuring the navigation of impediments and the ability to locate empowerments, right, in academic, financial, and cultural terms. Whenever persons ask me to consult at institutions, that's the first question I ask them. What are the financial and social, cultural, academic empowerments and impediments? And unless you've done the qualitative research to ask your students, you will not know that answer to that question, right? And so, I have a video that, due to technical difficulties, I want to show you now. It is an example of black resiliency in a college campus.
In fall 2012, the total enrollment, graduate and undergraduate, for African American males at UCLA was 660 students. That's 3.3% of the 19,838 other males enrolled here. Out of that 660 African American male students, 65% are undergraduate athletes. The number of entering male freshman students was 2,418. Only 48 of them are African American. The graduation rates for African American males at UCLA is 74%, which means out of that 48 freshmen last year, only 35 are predicted to graduate. When we were children, we learned how to mix colors with a paintbrush. We learned that white mixed with anything makes it brighter, but we wouldn't dare mix anything with brown or black, or else our entire creation would be ruined. What we failed to realize was that the untouched dark section of the paintbrush palette became the symbol of the melanin in our skin. The painter only used us to write words that were dark enough to be noticed on a white background. So if words are all we are good for, then don't you dare tell us to silence our voices when we choose to speak. Now you tell me that I should be proud to be at UCLA when only 35 of us are predicted to walk across that stage, when most of us are dropping out from the lack of financial aid, while Judy Olian, Dean of Anderson School of Management, just spent $647,000 on first-class flights and hotel stays. But waiting for an apology, it's asking for the impossible, because no snowflake in an avalanche ever feels responsible. But you tell me I should be proud to be a Bruin when we have more national championships than we do black male freshmen. It's evident that our only purpose here is to improve your winning percentage. So now black high school kids can care less about grades, just as long as the number on the back of their jersey doesn't fade. And you tell me I should be proud to be a Bruin. But according to Professor Sander, 3.3% is far too many black kids. On its perfectly paved roads, there are far too many black kids. This school is not diverse just because you put it on a pamphlet. But you'll name a building after Albert Conesaw, who publicly opposes affirmative action? The action that can make our fraction on your demographic pie chart look more than just a second hand on a clock. It's all talk, just to maintain this fraudulent reputation of this institutionalized racist corporation. They don't care about the cultural limitations of being a minority in society, so we have become our own painters with our own palettes, and we have voices that speak defiantly. So we ignite the flames to help us find the path to our future, increasing graduations, not incarcerations, transforming education because our numbers can't be any fewer. So don't be surprised that we have become rebellious for what has happened to us. When every black student in class feels like Rosa Parks on the bus, we are trying to rewind time with role reversal as our revenge, because we have no other choice when the university refuses to come to our defense. But we have come too far to let history repeat itself, even when they are peeling off the dark fur of the Bruin pelt, because our faces are just used to cover up from the public what's really inside, revitalizing lies to perpetuate your disguise. Stop pretending that the wounds of our past have healed. We're not asking for a handout. We're asking for a level playing field. Those with less opportunity are fighting for their position, trying to find their place, but those with privilege are hitting triples when they were already born on third base. So with all my brother's hopes and dreams that this university has tried to ruin, how the hell am I supposed to be proud to call myself a Bruin?
There's but one example. of resiliency, an example of self-actualization. I don't know how many of you, so I live on Twitter immediately, right? This hashtag and the video that came after it, I Too Am Harvard, is probably one of the most enlightening videos and campaigns that I've seen as it relates to using social media to bring light to a situation. What I was experiencing 20 years ago in college, in my predominantly white campus, that I experienced at here at the University of Utah, black students are experiencing at Harvard, at Yale, at Columbia, at Dartmouth, at Bucknell. The commonality is that they're all on predominantly white institutional campuses. The students did a campaign where they had drew discussions, basically, and responses. So the sister with the locks, her sign says, "No, I would not teach you how to twerk." She had been asked that by someone who attends, right? Someone else says, "I don't see color." And then the sister's response is, "Then you don't see me." Right? And it is based on a video, an empowering way to show self-actualization and realize that even though you are intellectually elite, you are still black on that campus. Right? And commitment to social justice. University of Missouri, for those of you who are not familiar, the abbreviated version, a black male was elected president of the student body. He experiences racial slurs in public. Other black students are verbally assaulted, being called an N-word on campus. They approach the president of the university, no response. Black students who are playing football say, "We will not play another game of football unless the president is fired." And he resigns. Full professor, so he goes back to his department, but he does resign, right? The students were committed this action to social justice. There's a manuscript that I have coming out. It is in Spectrum, a journal on black men. It won't come out until October, but I want to give you a preview of it as it ties into my talk tonight. And so it was a qualitative case study that explored how high-achieving black men embody and perform various forms of excellence within predominantly white campuses. There were three themes that emerged. One, major focus is the major focus, black plus male plus nerd, academic anomaly. I can relate to that. Intergenerational fulfillment. Participants' experiences with anti-black racism, which required resiliency, fostered higher order critical thinking, advanced the path to self-actualization, and reinforced commitment to social justice were excellent collegiate outcomes. So what do we know? The lack of post-secondary enrollment and degree attainment by black males is found to be coupled with racial and gender phenomenon found on predominantly white environments where racism is overwhelmingly present. The adverse impact of racism on black males manifests in the following ways: marginalized presence in predominantly white institutional environments, cumulative effects of racial battle fatigue, enduring racial microaggressions, and confronting race-related colorblind racism. The question: how do high-achieving African-American male collegians embody and perform excellence while attending a predominantly white institution? Guiding questions. What do high-achieving African-American male students perceive as crucial to college success? How do African-American male student leaders perceive and respond to the predominantly white institutional environment? Theoretical framework that we used, the mental proficiency and disciplinary initiation, deal with some of the quantitative methods, metrics that I talked to initially. Is ways of measuring intelligence that the university acknowledges as valuable in the campus. But as it relates to self-actualization and wanting to be socially responsible, currently there aren't measurable metrics that are valued by institutions. So this is why we chose this theoretical framework. I am a qualitative researcher. In order for me to know what happens, I have to interview you. I want thick, rich descriptions of the phenomena that you experience, the context, R1 institution, 7 black males participated. They had to lead in a predominantly black and a historically white organization. For organizational context, they were interviewed 3 times, 90 minutes each, did follow-ups, demographic surveys, and they were observed attending 3 meetings in each organizational setting. Definitions of the themes, major focus is the major focus. Perceptions of participants that excelling in their academic major areas could only be achieved if they dedicated strict, nearly singular focus to their studies and studying to be better prepared. Black male nerd equals academic anomaly. A student's ability to self-actualize and compare self-perceptions to environmental assumptions about what it means to be black male and intellectual, intergenerational fulfillment, desires to meet elders, and parental expectations of being excellent for the betterment of their communities, both locally and globally. Major focus is the major focus. The above quote from Nathaniel speaks to his interpretation of self-investment as not only the linchpin of his college success, but also his preparation to enter the field of civil engineering upon graduating. He says, I can only become a civil engineer if I do what is necessary to assure my place in civil engineering, which will better position me to get paid afterwards. I have to get all A's in the math-related courses like Calculus 2, which set me straight for particle dynamics, surveying, and thermodynamics. I mean, this is my major, my life, so I have to master it. Basically, keep the main thing, or the major focus on my major focus. Black plus male plus nerd, academic anomaly. Charles' understanding that his identity is cumulative, yet exists independently and overlapping racial, gendered, and intellectual segments is representative of having developed a heightened awareness of the intersections and effort to make meaning of interactions with his peers, faculty, and administrators. He says, I wonder how they see me prior to knowing I'm a nerd. Because I'm 6'3", not an athlete. They pile all the black stereotypes on me before hearing my academic credentials. Plus, as a male, some think I'm threatening, emotionally unavailable, or sexually promiscuous. So many layers. Look, I'm a black male. I'm a black male who is one of the smartest nerds you'll ever meet. And for some of those labels, they don't match. Guess I'll spend the rest of my life showing otherwise. And the last theme, intergenerational fulfillment. This perspective was central to participants' beliefs that the education is to be used as a catalyst for achieving black equity and was adamantly expressed by each participant. The opportunity to accomplish community betterment was typically practiced in tandem with the completion of leadership responsibilities and co-curricular organizationals. His quote, internships, summa cum laude, bank rolls, it all amounts to nothing if the work I do in college does not prepare me to transition into a profession that empowers me to earn for and provide for my black community. I stand on the shoulders of giants. GMOS sweat floor 60 hours a week to send my pops to college. He sacrificed financially so I wouldn't be in debt upon completing college. The ultimate goal is crystal clear to me, uplift my old people, raise my young people, prepare the next generation to live well, better than I did despite the racism I faced. Hopefully, my work will buffer their track. The black male student leaders in this study experienced every one of those areas in the theoretical framework. As it relates to them being aware of academic stakes, the lowest GPA of the participant in my study was 3.3. And he was nervous that he wouldn't be seen as smart with a 3.3. So they were mindful of their intellectual proficiency. They were critical about how do I build knowledge in my area, that is my major, and outside of that. How they resisted identity performance, again, to be black and male and nerd, those three things don't necessarily go together, right? So they were always asked to perform blackness in stereotypical ways that they were expected to by their faculty and peers, and they wanted to ultimately benefit black culture. Implications. Two important ones. Reassess current essential metrics to higher education as excellence in nuanced ways that explore what standards matter, what outcomes matter, what measurements inform change and priorities. Until there's a revolutionary change in higher education, black male excellence, tactics in the study will be judged as less valuable for institutional accountability and control and will receive less recognition and support. And so what does this all mean, right? How do we measure resilience, critical thinking, self-actualization, and commitment to social justice? The first recommendation is to ask questions. If I asked black students at Westminster how they experienced the climate, what would they say? If you asked them, what would they not say? right? The second one, provide a reward or accolade structure. When I go into places of business, I always see employee of the month. On campus, I never see student of the month. It'd be nice if I saw something that said, this is the student of the month. They confronted sexism. They contested that racial microaggression, and we celebrate that as a university. Allow unencumbered access to administrative hierarchy. For the most part, if my students need me, they can get in touch with me, right? A lot of times when students come to the office, they talk about the assignment for about 3 minutes, and then they talk about life for 57 minutes, so you're there an hour, right? To be able to be there and concerned matters to your students. They may never tell you. They'll tell someone else. And then someone will say, I took your class because I heard that you were to my friend. Right? Invest in critical counseling services. I'm unaware of institutions that hire counselors who understand theoretical frameworks surrounding racial microaggression, racial battle fatigue, racial trauma, suicide as a result of those things, stopout, dropout rates as connected to racism experienced on campus. As an institution, we have to value our students who are harmed, help them, heal them, and push them towards their graduation status. Right? Redefine success as attached to holistic. The brothers in the video, the students at Harvard, the students at the University of Missouri, I value those acts. They stem from a holistic place. Students are smart if they're in college. It is my assumption that they will graduate. The things that prevent them from graduating typically have little to do with intellectual challenges, right? And the last one is, decide what loco parentis means to your campus. When I go to campuses, I have to go to University of Arizona in 2 weeks. I ask, how far does the university extend from this place? So does Westminster College stop at the street? Does it stop at the end of the city, at the end of the county, at the end of the state borders? When students leave this campus, are they just people? Till they come back to your campus? Local parentis is a term that is attached to higher ed initially. As when you bring your kids to our campus, we will serve as their parents in your absence. And we are committed to doing that. I can only do that if I am committed to the whole student. I mentioned the Village earlier. The Village is a cultural leadership bridge program. It is for students who self-identify as Black. It is filled with 251 of the most exciting Black kids who are African, who are African Americans, who are African American and raised by Mormon white parents, who are biracial, who are multiracial. I am teaching them how to do all the things that I talked about in this presentation. So by the time they reach your campus, their level of critical consciousness will be higher than most students who come to your campus. Leadership advocacy, scholarship, community involvement culture. That is what we focus on in the Village. That is part of my pedagogy as a critical scholar. It is part of the people that I know that are administrators, that are in my trust and accountability circle. I challenge you as educators and students, as educators and administrators, to see your students holistically and empower them to express themselves. I had colleagues who I know at the University of Missouri who were saying, oh my goodness, these students are out of control. What are they doing? And so even though students are taught how to be social justice minded on their campus, when they turn and face an institution that is teaching them, it is problematic. There is less value, right? And so as students, I challenge you to hold your faculty, administrators, RAs on your floor, hold them accountable to contest injustice. It's never wrong, and I value it. Questions. Yes.
Is the Village What is your name?
Sean.
Sean, what do you do here?
I'm a student. I'm a freshman, and my major is international business.
Okay, go, Sean.
Is the village only for UU students?
So, the village is a K-12 structure. Has a curriculum, and it is in 7 middle schools and 3 high schools. But we do work with ambassadors that are at the University of Utah. It is our goal to extend into our collegiate network at Westminster and Weaver State to give an opportunity for persons to be ambassadors. There is a piece, a research piece called Fingerprints to Fingerprints that was conducted at the University of Utah that talks about how males of color are being routed, piped into prison. What we are trying to do with the village is create an alternative to that narrative, where we can educate kids that are in the 6th grade, kids that are in high school, prepare them to go to college, and have the kids who are already in college, educate them about the process, and then push them to graduate school. So, we are piping. Yes.
The situation at UCLA has been longstanding. It's been around for a lot of years. What advice would you give them for improving their recruitment activities in the school?
So, currently there are less than 180 black students at the University of Utah. University of Utah says that there are 35,000 students. I've made recommendations that there are so few black students that you can recruit them like athletes. So you can say, how many National Merit Scholars, Gates Millennial Scholars are in our state that are black? 50? 25? Right? As a professor, if the institution came to me and said, we need you to do some calls on these 10 black students who are National Merit Scholars, Gates Millennial Scholars, and recruit them to the University of Utah. After me being able to assess that structures have been in place to nurture them holistically, because my rep is on the line. And when I talk to somebody's grandma and tell them to bring your baby to the school, she can take her belt off on me whenever she wants, if that baby's harmed, right? Because he's connected or she's connected to me. The amount of resources that it would take to do that are minimal. When the institution shows that they care about you, you feel it. Athletes know when they're being pursued, right? Why can't Gates Millennial Scholars know when they're being pursued? I realize that the University of Utah is not Stanford. Some people don't realize that. And so there are some black students who are just not coming to the University of Utah. They're not coming to UCLA because they're going to Fordham, right? Or Buckland, wherever they're going, Cornell. And so, but there are other students who may come if they knew that the institution cared enough. I couldn't even imagine if I said, hey, it's Dr. Hotchkins, give me a call, University of Utah. What you doing? Who is it? Blah, blah, blah. You ever consider coming? No, I haven't. Here's the deadlines. Blah, blah, blah. We will connect you. We will ground you in a black church in the city. Take you somewhere where you can get your hair did, right? Take you somewhere where you can meet black faculty, you can meet black students. Pay for you to go to conferences to get you exposure to what it means to be a scholar at that school. That's institutional commitment. I don't see that anywhere in the country. To answer your question. Someone else? Yes.
How does a child get involved in this if they're not in those schools? If they're biracial or biracial?
Excellent question. So, last summer, Nedra and I decided to create a boot camp for parents of black children who are white, and black children, black parents as well. 10-week course, did well. One person said, well, what can you do? What can we do? Our kids don't go to the schools that the village is in. One parent said, how many people would it take for you to create something just for us? I said, if you can find 12 families, we'll do it. 16-week curriculum. They contacted us. We made it happen. Right? I think the hardest thing to fight through is when you tell a white parent, I'm going to attempt to give you the tools to educate you about how to protect your black children from white supremacy that seeks to destroy them. So we have real talks in the village. I'm built for real, right? And so if I say something and you are uncomfortable, it's not because of me, because I didn't personalize it. There's something within you and it rises to the top. There's nothing wrong with not knowing. I'm a black male. I don't have a playbook for how to raise black kids, even though I'm doing it, right? And so we work.
That's how you get in touch.
To answer your question. Yes, your question.
Oh, yeah. So I'm very great. I'm here at Westminster. I actually just recently moved to St. Louis, Missouri, and I actually heard about that event at the St. Louis College. But interesting thing that you may not be aware about was that this legislator at the college, at the college council, passed rules that it didn't allow them, like sports teams that went against the school presidents. They said they would lose scholarship money if they protested, spoke out at college events, at protests that schools didn't find particularly appropriate. So this was, in a sense, a way of controlling the sports team. I don't know if you were aware of that.
Right, and I was.
You were.
And I concur. It is a way of control.
Yeah, control of just be like, hey, you are our sports team. You are a huge play for us. We don't care about your mental influence.
Right. And so here's what I think happened at the University of Missouri. Luckily, the University of Missouri had a bye week the week before the students began to protest. Somebody called the president and said, look, the SEC is gonna fine us $1 million, and we're gonna get fined again for not playing this game against BYU. BYU is gonna get paid, and we're gonna get fined, right? You need to resign. Press conference. I'm regretful that I didn't make time for black students when they call with valid concern. That's what you said, right? But that's not what you said, and it cost him his job. So now, here's the ripple effect. Black chief diversity officers are being hired all over the country now. We don't want to be Missouri. Don't do that. As that even happens, I get a call. Dr. Hotchkins, what's going on? I know you got your thumb on the pulse of students, because they talk about you all the time. What do we do? Right? To respond to something, to prevent something happening, is not as valuable as when you are proactive in doing it as a way, as a culture of your institution based on how you value students holistically. Right? Anybody can do preemptive strikes. Students come look, we got all these things. We had a meeting, we got 20 things. Yeah, I'll take these things. Just don't get me fired, it's better. Right? That is responsive. I don't appreciate that. I appreciate consistent hiring practices that are diverse, that are strategic. Faculty members who have pedagogy that is not harmful. Misnomer. If I stand in front of your class and say, this is a safe space, I'm lying to you. Because that'll make it so, because I declare it. Right? It is about actively pointing out and deconstructing offense in your class and on your campus. If that's not happening, and again, it is not happening at the majority of institutions because, again, they don't value or don't measure holistic value that the students bring to the campus. You have a question? Yeah.
Yeah. What is your view on colorblindness?
Colorblindness, in short, is worse than racism. To be colorblind, you have to first acknowledge that someone is of color, then pretend that they're not. That's counterproductive. one time my son, since we moved to Utah, teacher said in a meeting, I don't want Osiris to be the best black man he can be. I want him to be the best man he can be. And I said, well, him being wrapped in blackness as man within these United States can get him killed in ways that being wrapped in whiteness will never get him killed. He has no other choice than to be the best black man he can be. Colorblindness is dangerous because it still compares everyone else to white in normalized ways, and it doesn't account for things like Black History Month, right? It doesn't account for me saying Nat Turner is my hero because he committed a slave rebellion to gain freedom because he never should have been enslaved in the first place. And someone say, that's horrible. He killed slave owners. It was awful, right? So colorblindness is, in my estimation, worse. Yes.
I'm curious about your ideas about programs like Posse that started earlier in the new millennium, where they'll bring a cohort into, you know, like an R1 institution like University of Utah or some other schools have been using this way of sort of peer support for underrepresented populations or, you know, predominantly white institutions. I know that's not a standalone solution, but how does that work within a bigger framework? Does that make sense?
Yes, and so cohort modeling, research says that cohort modeling works. The students move through courses together in a unit. They are able to study, have direct access to a professor who's been placed to guide them through coursework. Sometimes what happens is the pedagogy of the professor is not there. So what often happens is students of color are educating the professor about how to navigate their being students of color on the campus. And instead of the professor saying, this is what it means. Right? I've had an opportunity to be asked by the University of Utah to go to places and recruit students. And I tell them, do you want me to give them the sanitized version? Or the real version? Right? Because that's the only version I can give, is the real one. I think as long as there is thought and curriculum alignment with the people who are teaching the courses, with the administrators that the students will be exposed to in ways that are productive, you can create a buffer around students in that cohort that will lessen the harm that they ultimately experience on campus.
Okay.
So it has to be, because it can't just be in class. It has to ripple effect to extend outside of that.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes.
For people going into secondary education, whether administrative or teaching positions, what sort of systems and programs would you recommend to set up for students of color?
So in the absence of the village in your school, you have to be mindful that black and brown students are disciplined disproportionately in ways that white students who have more egregious outbursts are not disciplined, right? Different programs that teach persons how to go into secondary education, depending on the institution where you earn your degree, some utilize critical race theory, culturally responsive teaching, critical race pedagogy, and then other students graduate and never even heard about white privilege, right? And then they go into these schools and they see black and brown students as deficit. I ask my peers, what is an exemplary teacher? And they say, a teacher that never sends a student to the office. As a teacher, you should have a skill set that even the students that there's a cultural incongruence, right? And I don't want to centralize or generalize, but as you can tell by my suspenders and shirt, black people are just amazing, right? The ways that we express ourselves, some people who have cultural incongruence will say, oh, just over the top,
That Pete don't match those suspenders. And that bow tie, even though that bow tie is hot, it'll be hotter than a white shirt. Right? And so there's a disconnect. And so when one teacher says the student is acting out and disrupting class, another teacher says he is expressing himself. I'm gonna use this student to come help me teach this class, to help me divide students into groups, to help me educate their peers, to explain to me what it is to be black, how the student perceives themselves, and then they empower that student, right? Versus, oh, Leroy. Why are there 10 people standing around Leroy in a circle while he's talking about his brand new Jordan? So I can't start class, right? What I would be like, oh, those J's are cool, but those 10s, you get up on the taxi 12s. Because I got them Jordans, right? But you may not. So you don't even understand. You just see it as a disruption in your class. So you send it to the principal's office. Just to teach it like you're supposed to. Right? And so you have to create, if you can create programs like the Village, affinity groups work. Right? So this is Black History Month. Every classroom, every school in Utah should be talking about the greatness of blackness. Don't start at the slave ship. Right? Back. Talk about King Tut. Right? Continue to go back. Talk about Osiris Nice, my kid's name. Right? Don't just start at the slave ship. I tell students, well, persons who move into secondary education, don't use the word slave. Use the word enslaved. Africans were stolen, they were enslaved. To say enslaved says that someone enslaved them. If you start the conversation about the slave ship with the heinous acts of white supremacy, then it's okay for you to talk about it. Because then you have to say they were stolen. Where were they stolen from? They were stolen from Africa. Where Africa was before 1619, yes. Let's go back and talk about the greatness and how it was truncated. Then how does it disconnect culturally of some African Americans in America, even today, because of the legacy of slavery? So that's just an abbreviated answer. Yes.
Can there be less racial problems if there was more colored people in leadership roles at colleges?
So, the term color.
Yes.
I am comfortable with being called black. Blackness to me represents a mind space that I am in, right? And so I realize that as Du Bois talks about the narrative gate, the normative gaze of whiteness, blackness, separate from whiteness, is performed in ways that are not muted, that are not silenced, that are not lessened, right? There are some things that I'll never say in front of white people, ever. I was raised in a house that taught me self-preservation is important. We don't want you to be Emmett Till. We don't want you to be shot. Unarmed, right? So I'm fine with being called black. I would encourage you to never call a person of color for a variety of reasons, but mostly because color came after the N-word between Negro, Black American, African American, right? I think that Chris Rock in Vulture gives an example. He's asked about how black people have had better lives now because we got a black president. His response is, Ray Rice hits his wife, right? Batters his wife in an elevator. If Ray Rice doesn't get his wife again for 10 years, her life isn't better. He's stopped being as violent. Right? His connection was his daughters are growing up with white peers who are less violent than the ones that his grandfather grew up with. It is not that black people have gotten better. It is that white people have gotten less violent. Right? And so to answer your question, I think if the perspectives of people of color were shifted to be seen as brilliant, as exemplary, as grand as they really are in our communities as we see ourselves,
by white people, places of education will be better. That makes sense.
Okay. What does reparations look like on college campuses? Have a national conversation about it. What does it look like as it relates to educational institutions?
So what does reparations look like? That's an excellent question. If it is framed as, I have to prove that I'm black first, it's gonna look a lot different. I don't have a document that says that traces my lineage all the way back to that first nation. So I can say my people were stolen from Ghana this year and brought over. I don't have that. If, and I don't believe it ever happened, government just says, okay, everybody is black, you are horn, and we want to make it up. Right? I guess there would have to be initiatives around hiring of administrative faculty and staff who were either black or had a critical mindset, right? Because no matter what the resources are on campus, if persons are being harmed, it doesn't matter what the resources are. Students are going to be an environment that is harmed. There needs to be some type of financial opportunity, one that either addresses the gap. So if I'm coming to Westminster, and even though I got the ultimate, I got all the financial aid I could, I'm still $7,000 short, right? If I am allotted an opportunity to work, it needs to be coupled to my major. So I'm not in a bowling alley, or I'm not in the bottom of the anthropology building counting rocks, right? Something that is directly connected to an ambassadorship, or something that exposes me. A lot of students, they say they want to be an advertiser, and then they graduate without ever taking an internship, and they're like, man, I hate this job. I should have been a dentist. Right? So there have to be ways to show students, hey, you can be exposed to this so they can say, I want to, it's not for me. Or they're building capital throughout all their undergraduate years that they can take with them into the next job. There has to be some type of purposeful placement where the university says, we, like a headline, we will place these students upon graduation. I don't think reparations should be a monetary amount handed to someone. But I think it should, like Moses, partner Ray C, be utilized to create a clear path to graduation where students can, I can wear locks, a man, deacon can wear an afro, right? In the spaces where white students, faculty, staff have been taught, it's not cool to touch my hair without asking, right? It's not cool to ask what black people think, because I don't know, because it's just me, I know what I think, right? For me to see myself teaching me in class, right? Is there a black provost at my university? Is there a black associate APP, student affairs? How many black faculty are tenured on that campus? How many black directors on that campus? How many black RAs live in my room? On my floor, right? And again, it's Utah. So if I go to school in Langston, historically black, 95% black. Black resident, black everybody. Right? But it's the context of the institution. So it's supposed to be that way. And so, yeah, reparations, that is a good discussion to have.
We need to have it in this country.
Yeah, we do. But it's going to begin with, you got to prove that you're black, which is going to exclude a lot of, I think, that's how it begins. Anyone else? Yes?
So I have a question about the Village, because first of all, I think it's a wonderful program. However, has there been in the works or working with other organizations such as Latinos in Action with some sort of, yeah, like collaboration, because essentially Latinos in Acción, they kind of do similar things to like the Village. I know because I've worked with Latinos in Acción. Has that been in the works with collaborating with other organizations that seek to have a similar mission?
And so the village is a year and a half old. Mm-hmm. And so we are, the village is spelled with the I with parentheses around it, mm-hmm. which is symbolic of protection, ethnic enclave, safe space. To build our house internally first is fine. I've had discussions with the creator of Latinos in Action. We have not collaborated. I can't say why, but I can say this. The black students who are in schools in Utah are experiencing being invisible. They are hearing the N-word by people of color who are in their schools, but because there are so few of them, they are hesitant to say anything. Collaboration may come in the future, but today, I am not opposed to collaboration, but it has to look a certain way. Yes?
I have a follow-up question about collaboration, especially between different social identities, because of course individuals of different identities have completely different experiences, different types of oppression, different types of things that, and you know, like, I don't know, with my oppression of whatever it is to be a Muslim American or be anything, it's going to be completely different than yours or than a Latino's or than a woman's. But how do you think that this collaboration can happen by trying to bridge different experiences and find common ground?
So we were purposeful in saying that the village is for students who self-identify as black. There's an exercise that we do in the curriculum called the power of words. And I ask students, what is the word that you don't want to be called? Almost to an exact replica. My Muslim students who are African say it, terrorist. It is difficult for a girl who is in the middle school or high school to conceal her being Muslim because she is dressed a certain way. The N-word, even though it is on their radar, is less heinous because to be terrorist means you can be killed and eliminated because you pose a threat to America and period. These students are hesitant to move through these schools, right? In different ways than our African American students. So they never call terrorists, because it doesn't apply, right? My African students are being called terrorists because they're Muslim. My black students who are Christian are being called N-word. It is important to me that we collaborate within, across African, Muslim, African American, Christian, African American, Mormon, female, male, heterosexual, homosexual, that we are comfortable with ourselves before we go out there and do collaboration. Early last year, I remember the first year, we have a discussion. The Muslim girls are saying to the African American girls, why y'all dress like that? Y'all got tank tops on, showing y'all that. African American girls are like, what? Why you covering your head up, right? By the end of that discussion, there was an understanding about how the patriarch is operating to oppress both of them, even though they are Muslim and Christian. That is an example of a collaboration within our space. Again, I'm not opposed to collaboration. But the collaborations that are happening about what it means to be black, how do you experience blackness? There are students who are multiracial and biracial who have been cut off from their black identity, who are learning by interacting with their friends in the village, cultural reference points, right? When I ask students, my black students could tell me who Martin Luther King is, right? They couldn't tell me who Thurgood Marshall is. So we have to have discussions about this legacy that you stem from. So if your mom was white, or your mom was Filipino, or your mom was another race identity, you still black. To me, because one of your parents is black. Or you, there's a person, you know, if he comes to the first day
He's white. He looks like you. Right? And I'm saying those black kids, they're protected. North Davis kids, they're protected. They can survive anywhere. They say, what you doing here? You ain't black. He said, my grandma was black. I'm supposed to be. He had blue eyes. I was like, wow. He's passing for white in a whole other way. Right? And so, again, collaboration with them is the focus now. How are we on time? Okay.
More question?
Any more questions? Yes.
Can you briefly say something about what you would and would not say, in mixed company?
Right.
Like what you would and would not say in mixed company. I teach Black diasporic literatures here, so I'm always saying things in mixed company. And one of the problems, not the problems, but one of the issues that I'm struggling with is balancing that attention to language, right? When do you read the words on the page that are problematic, right? When do you read the N-word? How do you even do you use the N-word, right? And the permission that because you see it on literature, that it could be said by anyone, right, and it's thrown around. Like, how would you handle that then in mixed company?
Right, and so I have students who are reading Huck Finn right now at different schools, and their white teachers are reading the N-word. Every time they just say it, everybody looks at them, and they look back at the teacher. Not only are they associated being black with being the N-word, but the teacher is saying it's okay for me to say it, and when you respond in class, it's okay for you to say it, just to get you. Just so as much that you don't say it about someone. I would shut all that down from day one, right? This is my class. That's one thing about being a professor. These are my rules. They're on the syllabus. If you don't like it, take another section, right? So we're not having that. I'm not, A, because curriculum violence is occurring by you even selecting the book and then forcing them to sit through it to earn that A. They don't have the option to not in high school. They gotta take their class. And they gotta hear that book read aloud, right? Because they have to get their grade to graduate. They're forcing themselves to be traumatized. And the system supports them. So if it were me, I would either not select that book, right? I would tell students, like I told them before in all my classes, there will be terminology that is used in this class. True, you have the First Amendment right to say whatever you like, not without consequence, right? Because I'm 40 plus, the way that I would respond to you now, hearing you say the N-word, is different than a black male in my class that's 20, right? And if you say it, he probably gonna give you that look. And I might be like, right? He might be waiting on you out of the class. So you got to say it. Hope it was worth it, right? Because the consequence may be something that you can't deal with. So because you are empowered as the teacher of that class to address those issues, to set those ground rules at the beginning of your class, to write them in your syllabus so it is part of your written policy. So they can't say they didn't know. So if you get a call from your dean or your chair of your department, this is how my syllabus was, I handed it to every student. And I told them these are the rules of my class for engagement, and you can take another session if you don't like it. And they still said the N-word.
But the aspect of mixed company, right? Because I teach the college setting. I don't teach kids. That shuts down conversations real quick, right? Because no matter how great I think I did in the class one day, there's always the students who are like, well, I'm afraid to speak because she has all these rules.
Right.
And as a woman of color, I'm like, well, there are consequences. Yeah, I'm just telling you the consequences. I'm not really enforcing rules upon you. I'm just telling you what the truth is, right? And I wonder, the shutting down of conversations, right? When you teach Black diasporic literatures, where every other word, every text that I choose has, you know, racial epithets in it.
Right.
For a purpose, right? For a very political purpose. There's that shutting down a conversation. I think that's something that I struggle with. in mixed company.
And
when my students of color, I'm like, well, you know, you all know what I'm saying, right? And they're like, yeah, but when it's not, when you all know what I'm saying does not mean the same thing across the room, that's a problem.
So at the University of Utah also, I took a class about Du Bois. And Du Bois and some of his writing used the N-word. We were in class once. White student says, well, I teach eighth grade, and I let my students say the N-word. Well, you didn't say the N-word in class, right? Again, I'm flashing back, so I look at him. And I shouldn't have said this. I swear I shouldn't have said it. I said, I want to do something to you tonight that's going to make you tell your great-grandchildren about what happened. Don't you ever say the N-word again. That was the last time I went to that class. I started crying. I had to walk out of that class. I personalized white supremacy in that moment. I'm glad that I left the class, because I would have lost my opportunity to get a Ph.D. if I hadn't. I talked to the professor after that and said, I can't come back to your class. He allowed me to submit my paper. I missed like 6 weeks. He allowed me to do my assignments. And then the next semester, he called me to his office and said, here is my new syllabus with a policy that I've added to it that will not allow that to happen again. Right? And so I give mixed company. Right? I don't want to hear Latinos say the N-word. I don't care if it's a person of color. Because when I hear it, it's the same response. Right? And so shutting down, some conversations don't need to be had. Because what we don't want to create is spaces for horizontal hostility across people of color to happen. Right? So now, white supremacy is my enemy, and now there's Latinos in my class that said the N-word, so I don't like them either. And I heard Pacific Islanders saying at the high school, so I don't like them either. Right? So it's more about some things just don't need to be said. Right? I know what it is. Say the N-word. I know what it is. I have an option. I don't have to say the word. And so some conversations need to be shut down. And masturbation. Because again, you can keep it real if you want to. But the reverberation from that, real pain, might be something that you can't deal with. Not you, but the students in class. And you are shepherding them through the learning process in your class. Because what you don't want to happen is, we was using the N-word in Professor So-and-so's class. So they don't trap you, get whooped. Or they invest value to it, right? Because you gave them permission to use a professor. And they trust you, because you're the authority in that class. And I'm not trying to tell you how to run your class. Okay?
Thanks again. This is a really thoughtful and provocative discussion, and lots of directions to sort of turn with this material.
Hold on for 1 second.
Yeah.
Where y'all at, though? Okay, continue.
So just one quick announcement before we wrap up tonight. The final Bastian Diversity Lecture Series will take place on Wednesday, the 17th of this month, so 2 weeks from tonight, 7:30 p.m. right here in the Gore Auditorium. It is a panel discussion called The Shifting Terrain of Financial Aid and Student Loans, a primer and provocative panel discussion. It will feature experts from the University of Wisconsin, the University of Utah, our own Jenny Ryan of the Financial Aid Office, and our own Tashelle Wright will be on that panel. If you're a student, you'll want to come out and find out what people are talking about, free college in the future, what about changing financial aid and financial loans. There's going to be a lot of sort of subjects broached here. So if you're a student especially, I'd strongly suggest you come out and hear what's on the cutting edge. Thanks, everybody, and have a good night.